isile cita ka poji barasa bela dandete dilfile muka ga moji gala pire jiratani anani dada tu jira ka moji tanambarete anani dada tu jira ka moji tanambarete
oromia oromia
Dilfile muka ga moji gala pire jirateni anani dada tu jira ka moji tanambarete anani dada tu jira ka moji tanambarete
oromia oromia
So what would you say have been some of the effects of state control and repression on Oromo people's indigenous cultural heritage and traditions, some of which you have been discussing with us here?
Oh, that's a disaster. Actually, the last 120 or 50 years has been a genocide, a cultural genocide, systematic genocide against the Oromo. And you can prove it. I don't know whether we have the time for it or not, but I could tell you how, in fact, with the support from outside, with the introduction of gunpowder to that part of the world, the Christian Abyssinia, their effort has been to simply physically get rid of the Oromo. So you see, you read this in history. Very recently, myself and Dr. Anisa Kasam, who is also my wife, we're publishing an article on violence, state violence against the Oromo in the Horn of Africa. So the history of our relation to Abyssinian state is a history of violence, one-way violence. The Abyssinians are armed, they had the gunpowder, and the musket actually proved superior. That's how the Oromo culture got destroyed. You see, these are the things that Alibra sings when he says mal jadani mal mal himani o gaya dan ibapani gafan wallalani. You know, that's what happened at Chalanko. Clearly shows not the racial superiority of the Abyssinians. It only shows the superiority of the musket gun as provided by Christian Europeans in the West. So Dr. Tadesa Eba has compiled the amount of ammunition in his book Gadame Elba, what Abyssinians acquired. In fact, one wonders whether any one European colonial power had that amount of firearms and ammunition at that particular time. So the Oromos were simply massacred because the Abyssinians were trigger happy, and they could see what the gun can do. And so this ingrained Abyssinian superiority is what the gun did, and they really still believe that it is their strength rather than the technology provided to them by Europeans that made them superior. They mistook that as their own innate strength, which is ignorance anyway. But by Abyssinia, I think we should make a distinction, because these people who do these things don't even represent their own people. Their own people, I think. In Gondar, I have studied Gondar and Gojam, and I have talked to the ordinary people in the countryside. They don't really relate to this state ideology and all. These guys, they have been repeatedly indoctrinated by the church, and they know the church, and they know the saints, and they live their life, and they don't even know what their elite or people who think to come from them have done to other peoples. I could give you an example. A certain historian, an Amara historian by the name Taklasadik Makuria, writes in praise of Minilik. He wrote, Alian Yalchalon Kamatries Gara, English Yalchalon Kairoplan Gara, Abadanyo Gaptoba Minishirin Nabaroge Ujigra, Lazar Alterrafam Alek Agamara. Now, this is an Amara historian writing. He is saying a genocide is carried out against the Gemara. By the way, according to a certain Paulson, an English major who visited Ethiopia, or you know, the southern Ethiopia region in 1936, and published a book called Ethiopian Reality, he gives a figure that the Gemara population was reduced from 1 million to only 20,000. The population of the Kafa was reduced from 2 million to 100,000. The Oromo population was reduced from 10 million by half. These are all recorded documents. Therefore, my answer to your question is a genocide, physical genocide and cultural genocide, economic genocide, you name it, they did it.
How about some specific state policy? Now you are discussing about, you know, the consequence of the initial conquest, the violence that came with the conquest at the earlier stage. How about a specific state policy of cultural genocide, or, you know, cultural repression that has been implemented by Menelik, Haile Selassie, the Derg, and the present government? Can you mention a few of those policies?
You know, there are even, take what they say in Galan Nagari Piasa Igabam. Galan Nasagara Yadere Igamad. Kagala Gari Yebala Baamatuya Karawan. Lagala Nabsabat Diakon Machayan Nasaw. Galan Min Beta Christian Wusha Beta Christian Aigabam. You know, the abuse of the Gala is like a policy. It's unwritten policy.
What's the objective? Why?
The objective is to break, reduce you. If somebody calls you a donkey for 50 years, then you tend to accept that you are a donkey. You know, the Gala is always opposed to the Abyssinians are. There is this dichotomy, the civilized, the barbarian, the settled, the horde, nomad, the highland, the lowland, the Christian. This dichotomy is what the policy of, in the process of creating a civilized Abyssinia, they have, the other part has been reduced to, and then people like Ullendorff has the audacity to say that the Gala has nothing to contribute to the civilization of Ethiopia. They have neither material nor intellectual culture. This is a bully. This is a bully. And when I called him a bully, they all shouted in Kyoto, He is abusing a nation, and you cannot call him a bully. So this is what they do. So Europeans also contributed to the denigration and to the genocide of the Oromo. And this is what we want the world to understand. They are contributing to it today.
Why?
I don't know. The general public in the West are good people. I don't think they know or they like what is happening to Oromo. They just don't know what their governments are doing all over the world. And they talk about democracy. They want to teach us humanity, human rights, yet their governments are all over the world, you know, telling people how to behave while they themselves are arming hooligans to massacre people. So
I think there is a link between the two questions that you was asking about what's Oromuma.
Mm.
Because a nation that knows itself mm-hmm. is probably ready to defend itself too. But what would the second question about, and you responded to, say by there was a cultural genocide, and what you discussed about Gala and whatever, you say it's part of the cultural genocide, but you know, imperial systems don't always sustain themselves by physical violence alone.
Yeah.
They have other forms of policies in which they sustain the system. Lord Lugard said, thrash them first and then reconcile them. Yeah. Well, that reconciliation is not an actual reconciliation, but it is also a benign form of violence. Could you speak to that, like to speak in a sort of systematic way under the Derg, under the Haile Selassie, not just the physical violence, which you said is documented,
yeah,
but policies that are meant to inflict cultural, economic, political violence.
Absolutely. It's, you know, they have a religious dimension. The Orthodox Church is bent over, you know, dehumanizing. Like they will tell you, you know, there is this Fikare Mariam, which says that whoever slept with a gala is like a person who have slept with an animal. They have the audacity to write this and preach it in public.
They still say, today?
Oh, absolutely. It's a church document, you know, it's a spiritual book. Fikare is a book like Vicari Jesus, Vicari Michael, Vicari Mariam, all these are church books that they use against us. And they tell you that the gala will be burnt in the last circle, you know, in hell. There is the last circle. Well, it is even worse than hell itself. So when Mary was taken down to the, actually, it's translated from Dante's Divine Comedy. It was first translated into Arabic, then they translated into Abyssinian language, and they used that. And the character, one of the characters in there, is made to be a gala. And you know what? You know, the Abyssinian sayings and literature and everything leaves no doubt in terms of, you know, the religious nature of the abuse of the gala, if you want to look at it from religious point of view. Second, you know it, during Haile Selassie in schools, we were told that Haile Selassie is Jesus, you know. Mangustu la Dawit Burake ulla semi. You know, this is what we used to. Mangustu la Dawit Burake ulla semi. Tabukola indante alla saufusum minim yellemi. This is what they taught us, indoctrination of the superiority of the one group over the other. So the gala come is at the bottom of the ladder when they teach you what you are. They have history, they tell you we are Abyssinians, people of history, we are people without history. They are people of culture, we are people without culture. They have literature, we are people without literature. They have alphabet, we are people without alphabet. They are the civilized, sedentarized people. We are the nomadic hordes that invade their space and kill people at will. And these are all fabrications, and they are meant to psychologically dominate you. And basically, it's a genocide. It's a psychological war waged for over 100 years now. And they don't stop it. And we have seen it under Haile Selassie. The Derg did the same thing in a new, he called it socialist. But how can, under a military dictatorship, people were clapping socialism, you know? Who said that and the West were amplifying, saying, calling Mengistu a communist government. Mengistu is a brutal military dictator. It was not socialism. Who, if you were to do research, and which I encourage young Oromos to do, who were the people really that Mengistu killed? Now, the Red Terror, a friend of mine who is now the late Jean-Pierre, his name is Jean-Pierre, he's been doing research on this Red Terror, and according to him, 80% of the people that died in both Red and White Terror were Oromos, 80%. So they would use any excuse to, and the idea, what they do is to, if there is an Oromo who happens to be emerging as a leader, they target him. They will either assassinate the character, get rid of him physically. This is a common practice. This is what we have lived in Ethiopia. And they tell us Ethiopia. And how can you be an Ethiopian when the system itself excludes you and doesn't allow you? If my grandfather was not able to be an Ethiopian, why should I wait for another 100 years to be an Ethiopian? It simply means that there is something wrong with this Ethiopia that cannot digest the Oromo. So, in my view, I think this government of ours and its policy would not have worked and would not work if outside powers don't sustain it. The outside powers, particularly the West, have a moral responsibility, because you guys who are growing up, you're going to watch these things. Today they watch as Oromos are dispossessed of their land in the name of development, investment, in the name of, and you know what is the paradox is, as Oromia develops, Oromos are impoverished. That's a paradox. Oromos are dispossessed to give way to some alien group who call themselves superior people, and they come and take over your land, and you're chased out from a land that you have occupied for God knows in 1,000 years. So really the predicament of the Oromo is the enemy is really supported by a very powerful outsiders. And how can people who are denied proper modern education, proper health, modern health service, proper basic service in the country, put up with mighty powers that fly tanks and fire launchers and missiles, and all these are provided by your government, if you like.
Earlier you mentioned the inability of Ethiopia to digest, as the word used, or incorporate or integrate Oromo into itself, its identity.
Yeah.
What is Ethiopia? What is the Ethiopian identity? And why is it? Why is that identity? And after you define what this Ethiopian identity is, why is it unable to integrate? Why is the Oromo, your grandfather and you, are unable, to, are yet to be able, and or unwilling, for that matter, to be Ethiopian? What happened?
And I'll tell you what they teach us in the school then. What they teach us in the school is, like, Ethiopia is divided into two. There are people of what they call Semitic descent and people of African descent. People of Semitic descent count their genealogy through Queen of Sheba, King Solomon, and all these romantic affairs between these. And then people of African descent are inferior, innately inferior. This is what the church preaches, because they use the Hamitic myth again. You know, Oromos are, according to the Orthodox Church, which they still preach in their churches, Oromos are descendants of Ham. And Ham was cursed. And therefore, it is the wish of their father Noah and the will of God that we should be slaves to our brothers who are Semites. That's what they teach us. So this is the ideological dimension. Mm-hmm. The economic dimension is that the Gala actually doesn't own land. It's like the Gala is an invader. He just arrived from nowhere during 16th century, and in fact brought darkness to magnificent civilization of Abyssinia. This kind of nonsense is still being taught in the schools. That's why when they displace Oromo from his land, it's like, it's biblical. Mm-hmm. It's a reclamation of the land that they lost during the 16th century. So modern colonial empire that we see now is a reclamation of a state that previously existed and only disrupted by these barbaric Gala invaders. These are the kind of terminologies that they use. And I don't think this is going to bring about peace and development.
Let me just ask, how is it that for Ethiopian elites, on the one hand, they have been preaching Ethiopian unity, and on the other hand, are completely unwilling to do away with these myths that are essentially dehumanizing?
Yeah, but when they talk about unity, they're actually, they have already given everybody a place. They've assumed their place, which is a higher chair, you know, which the ideology has already defined. They are superior because of this descent ideology, and you are inferior and subordinate because of this descent, African descent. In Ethiopia, let me tell you, when they see a black man, they call him Shanko. Actually, as far as I know, Shanko is the name of a black dog. So if a people have the audacity to refer to a human being as a black dog, then there is no limit. There is no limit to how far they can go. And the world should realize what is going on over there. And actually stop them for their own good, for their own good. Because when it gets out of hand, everybody would be a loser. We have seen it in Somalia. It has destroyed the country. We have seen it in Rwanda. All these, the superiority of the Tutsi, that's what it generated, a genocide. And I'm worried. I worry all the time, because I want us to challenge each other with words that rather than with swords. But if they delay it for too long, could be very bad. Could be bad for everybody.
It's interesting that you're mentioning about these things. About a week ago, a program was aired on Al Jazeera, probably the first time an international media has aired about Oromo. And one thing that the journalist who was unaware of the Oromo was asking was, oh my God, why are people so mean about Oromo? Exactly, I'm sharing your being, you know, your fear of what might happen, you know.
Absolutely, because if you push people too far, regardless of what these thugs imagine Oromos are human beings. They're neither superior nor inferior. As human beings, if you push them beyond the limit, they will react. And if they react, it could be bad for everyone, including the Oromo.
So
we should worry about our future. We should worry about the future of our neighbors, the people we have lived with for hundreds and hundreds of years. So there is some kind of insanity going on.
But he's asking you about an explanation for why Ethiopians and or other people in Ethiopia are so mean towards the Oromos.
And also unwilling to even engage in these conversations. I mean, you know, we saw so many people against the fact that this, you know, this show was being aired and that the topic of discussion was Oromo and that Oromos would be telling their own stories. So we see this persistent, you know, challenge to Oromos speaking out and speaking for themselves.
I think everybody can come into this because my knowledge is not any better than we have lived through this.
Could it be? You know, earlier when you were speaking in response to the question that he asked you about race,
yeah,
you said the Oromo don't have any concept of race.
Yeah.
Everybody is children of God.
Yes,
or children of humanity. That really speaks to this ancient idea that the Oromos respected human rights, the human rights of everybody, because they are children of God.
Yeah.
Oromos are also people of peace. Naga is what constitutes the social organization of the Oromo.
Absolutely.
But why are people so mean? What you described about violence, physical violence, economic violence, cultural violence, and what was captured in that question of the journalist about meanness, could that be because of the Oromo's demographic weight? Why would they be unwilling to work and live with Oromos? What would be the explanation in your view? Could that be demography? Could that be what?
Like I said, you know, this is there are multiplicities of reasons for this. Sure. One, the people who rule us are underdogs. These are minority. All in Oromia, they are extreme minority in Oromia, and they would use any means like divide and rule and. They would use violence, they would use, it's like, it shows how insecure they are, that they carry a protracted kind of propaganda and physical violence and educational violence and crossing your boundaries and expropriating your land. And it's like they will never sleep unless they make sure that you are made harmless, totally castrated. That's, I think, the kind of mentality that we witness. How do they achieve this? They achieve this by external support. So this has to be underlined several times. External support. I think the British government is responsible for aiding successive regimes that are violent. Mm-hmm. The American government is responsible for supporting fascists who have massacred people, and other Western, the French, the Italians, they have armed these guys against us, against harmless population, against populations that only carried at best a spear. They armed them with musket guns. They armed them with tanks. The Russians did the same. And they do this also because, you know, they have a share, they have a stake in it. But we are saying, you can't just continue killing us. This has to stop somewhere. And we're telling this to all governments who support these wrong regimes. They should instead make a positive intervention so that we, in this part of the world, in the Horn of Africa, could come together and peacefully settle our differences and start a new chapter in this part of the world. If they don't do that, and if they want this tradition of violence to continue, then I don't know. I don't know what's...
I just want to comment on this. I think it's very important to underline the fear that has been fabricated and inherited from generation to generation. I think the sources, I agree with Dr. Gamachu, is the myth. The myth of the founding myth of the state.
You mean the fear of the Oromo?
Yeah, the fear of the Oromo. The founding myth of the state that degenerates the Oromos, that turns them into subhumans, dehumanizes them. It doesn't just dehumanize them and turn them into inferior, but also in savages who can rise up one day and bring a vengeance against the others. I can see continuity between the savage myth, the savage theory of the past, and the secessionist theory of today.
Absolutely.
Yes,
and when Oromo, the issue of Oromo came,
yeah,
during Haile Selassie, before that, it was a savage, the backward.
Absolutely.
Before that, during Tedros, it was the dangerous.
Yes.
Then we are the inferior.
Yes.
Then it turns now secession, the question for self-determination, to be equal.
Yes.
It turned into a secession. Now
the people who want to break away the country.
Who want to break away the country and destroy the livelihood of everybody. Securitize as a strategy.
Absolutely.
The population, which is informal through these religious institutions, through academic institutions, to fear the Oromo, mm-hmm, buy into this state-sponsored propaganda and turn into savages themselves. When the issue of the name of Oromo arises, their blood boils and they engage into this irrational fear I call Oromophobia.
Yeah,
I think that's
absolutely.
I think another dangerous element of that is that this fear is incredibly blinding, and which is why even today we cannot talk about this historical facts. I mean, many of Ethiopians deny historical facts, and so it's incredibly disturbing.
Yeah, you know, the whole thing is based on and derives from self-denial, you know. Ethiopia has written a history that is not really Ethiopian. They have written the history of Queen of Sheba, King Solomon, and they talk about, you know, nowadays they even say, you know, they have equated what exists in Ethiopia with Latin and Greek civilization, sort of. They placed it, they have given it a place, while we are considered barbarians. So what they say is, every time Oromo complains that life is repressive, they say, oh, they're going to destroy this civilization, mm-hmm. civilization that doesn't exist. I have been studying for 7 years. I've been going to Amara region. The Amara region suffer from the same disease, from the same illiteracy, from the same, I just give you this, this is a very interesting experience. In Ethiopia, they want to portray like the north is literate, the south is illiterate. I went to the north to carry out some consultancy job regarding HIV/AIDS. So when they asked me how we should go about it, I was equally ignorant. I said, they told me that in Eastern Gojam zone, there were 51,000 priests. And I said, this is good. So, in HIV, there is what they call education, information and communication, EIC material. We produce EIC material in Amharic, and I said, we give it to the priests, let them teach in all the churches. And then the guy told me, these priests don't read and write. And I found out that this is really a crime. While in history department they tell us that the North have had alphabet for 3,000 years, here even the priest who is supposed to be literate doesn't know how to read the symbols. It's a memory, he repeats from memory. So, the oppressive nature of this system is not really limited to Oromo alone. Mm. But since it is religious, since this system doesn't make a difference, there is no difference between Abyssinian religion and Abyssinian history. Old Testament is their religion and it's also their history. So the mention of Ethiopia in the Old Testament, for them, is like God mentioned it. Therefore, it has to be accepted by everybody. This is a kind of attitude that we're confronted with. And this is an obstacle to all forms of development and mental change in the area. And particularly the elite, who, as we have discussed, feels threatened by Oromo asking for human rights. Mm-hmm. It threatens them because they want a perpetual slavery of the Oromo so that they could feel that they are better human beings, kind of mentality.